Next, we will have a look at TypeDef. TypeDef is a little bit of syntactic sugar. That means it makes our lives as programmers easier by simplifying code. So basically, it creates an alias for previously defined data types. So I can say TypeDef and given type, please name it as a new type name. Okay, here I have said TypeDef struct card. So whatever was previously called struct card should be named as card type T. And now I can use card type T as a data type, instead of that I would use struct card, okay, which includes some white space, sometimes harder to read, and so on. Okay, it doesn't actually create a new data type, it only creates an alias. Often what you do is that you underscore, as you create this little suffix, underscore t at the end of a variable for non-trivial types to indicate that this is a kind of a structure. You can also use this for standard types, like I could say typedef underscore bool, whatever was called underscore bool is now named bool. Okay. A good thing about it that you can make it simple to change data types throughout the whole code without changing the code. For example, you could say by default, I may want to use a 32-bit integer for math, but maybe I want to change it to floating point. Okay. So you can just define a new type, my type or something, and then you initially use this as your known type, and later you can replace it with float. Good. So next we talk about unions. Unions are similar to structs to some extent by the way you declare them in particular. So we can create any number of members to a union, similar to a struct. So instead of saying struct, we can say union. So that looks syntactically exactly the same. However, the semantic meaning is different. The semantics of a union is that you can store only one element of one of its members at a time. Okay? Here I can store either the floating point value y or the integer, or 16-bit integer x. You cannot store both at the same time. And the benefit of using a union is that you can share the memory space, conserving some storage, but you have to take care to know which element you actually store. You have to know, did I store X or did I store Y? So often programmers store in a union in a structure, and then inside the structure they remember which data type they have stored. Did they store X or Y? And then they can get back the right value. So let's have a look at the memory representation and how this works that they share memory space. Basically, when you as a compiler, if you would be the compiler, you have to create this representation. You would take the biggest size of any type inside it. So here we have a 4-byte floating point value and a 2-byte integer value. So now you know the whole data type needs 4 bytes. And then you would align it so that those data types overlap. So in this case, we would at byte 0 probably store our 2-byte unsigned integer. So you can see these memory regions overlap. So what happens if I first assign a floating point value y, I write those 4 bytes with some valid data. And if I then would assign x, I would overwrite only those 2 bytes with whatever content I store into it, which then, if you would try to read y again, would probably lead to a problem. So unions can be used for some very nice, I wouldn't say tricks, but nice programming tasks. In this particular group work or your own, you know, thinking process, we would try to access the bytes of an integer again. Before, you remember, we used memcopy, and we used an integer of 4 individual bytes to get the data. Now we want to use a union to get those 4 bytes. Think about it a little bit, and I would also appreciate it if you could share some of your insights in the respective group for your practicals on Friday. Okay, proceed once you are done. Good, here we see actually now as the solution. So it is very simple. We store basically in one union, we store our 4 bytes of an array and we store our 32-bit integer. So now one of the other, they have the same size, and whichever I write, I can read from the other. So I can create from our data T type, I create first a type def, so I say union data T. This was our previous type, should be named now data underscore T. Then I create a variable V, and I set this integer part here, var, to our number again. And now I can access then this B, which were the individual bytes, and print them here. Maybe that's a bit more elegant, a bit more clear. Good. And last, we look at bit fields. So a bit field defines the size of the variables in bits, and it can be stored inside a structure. It's often used particularly for networking protocols and when you really want to deeply access hardware. You can use it for unsigned or signed integers. So here we have a structure bit card T, and we said we want to store face as an unsigned integer with 4 bits, suit with 2 bits, and color as 1 bit. Basically, it looks a bit like this. We see the bits. The bits itself, they are consecutive in memory, but there might be a gap inside. That's why I plot it this way, which is a bit the discretion up to the programming environment. So the only difference is that you use this colon and you specify the number of bits. Okay, so there is also a way to define unnamed elements, which then give you the way to exactly lay out this structure in memory as you want it, particularly for, again, for network protocols and so forth. So here we have A, which is 5 bits, and then we have, there is no gap. Basically, we have 3 bits of an unsigned, which has no name. Okay, so this is kind of padding, whatever bits there are. And then we have 4 more bits, which is variable B. Right, and then if you use an unnamed bit element and you specify 0, then you would move to the next storage unit boundary, typically 4 bytes. Okay, so you have really a way to control the padding. Okay, this is a very specific thing. I generally advise not to use it, but it's here for completion, okay?